Welcome everyone back to another exciting afternoon session in this exciting week here. It's actually one session I was particularly interested in, and I'm happy to share this one. My name is Jens Jascher, and I'm going to guide you through this afternoon here. So we'll start the afternoon session with a plenary talk by Francisco Villaescusa-Navarro on a review on simulation and machine learning. And I've been asked to be very strict with time. Francisco, you have 50 minutes talk plus 10 minutes question. I'll give you an acoustic signal roughly 3 minutes before the end of the talk, and I use this device. So because I've been asked to be very strict with questions and we see a lot of interactivities on the Slack channel, this is a long talk and there might be lots of online discussions. If you want to help us figuring out the most important questions that we could ask at the end of this presentation, then I want to use your swarm intelligence, and please upweigh the topics that you like most with an emoji of your favorite choice, and we hope then that we get out the most relevant questions for the community out there. So with these words, I hand over to you, Paco. Thank you very much.
So thank you, yes. Thank you, yes. And thank you very much for the opportunity. And I apologize for not being there. You know, I have a little bit of difficult visa situation, so I cannot really go to Europe right now. You know, I cannot really go home. And, you know, it's really a mess. You know, I have a baby and even my family has not seen the baby and it's 20 months old. So, yeah, anyways, hopefully things will change quickly. So, I will be talking about the simulation review, basically what is the state of in terms of simulation that we have right now in the whole community, but also like application of machine learning on this. So also like Elizabeth said, I apologize in advance. The literature is becoming very, very large. It's a little bit hard to keep track of everything. So I have done my best to put, you know, all the references, but I'm sure I'm missing many of them that are very relevant. So apologies in advance for this. Okay, so this is the outline of the talk. I would like first, very briefly, like motivate why do we need simulation? So simulation can be used for many things. I just want to, maybe in this talk, you know, emphasize the need of this for a kind of probably the most important things that we can do in cosmology, you know, like maybe read all the information that is in the universe. So I'm gonna try to motivate in this thing, but you know, can be used for many other things. Then I will be discussing about the main types of simulation that we have right now. On one hand, we have embodied simulations, and on the other hand, we have full hydrodynamical simulations. So I will be, you know, reviewing the two of them and also application of machine learning using both. Then I will be touching a little bit about other things that we can do besides, you know, the typical things of accelerating your simulations, interpolation, and these kind of things. Maybe like learning new physics. And then I will discuss very briefly whether, you know, we can trust these kind of neurosimulations that we are now starting to produce, you know, as a community. And also a little bit about responsibility. You know, I will show you in one slide something I think is very interesting, but I have no idea what is going on. So I don't know if, you know, this should be even advertised or not. And then I will conclude. Okay, so what is the problem? So the problem is that we're spending billions of, you know, dollars, euros, Swiss francs, you know, yens, whatever currency you have. And we have this amazing data from these upcoming surveys, right? Euclid, LST, DESI, all these different surveys. And basically we are right now, I will say we are not really able to extract all the information that is in these surveys, basically because our theory predictions are not good enough to carry out this task. Even, you know, at 2021, I would say most of the people, not everybody, but most of the people still are using the power spectrum. And we know many people have shown that the power spectrum is suboptimal when you go to nonlinear scales. And we also know that on nonlinear scales, there is a huge amount of cosmological information. So we want to extract this information. I mean, why not? So the typical example comparison that I do this sometimes, you know, with more outreach talk is that, for instance, if you think like maybe 100 or 200 years ago, and we were looking at the hieroglyphs, I mean, at that time, we were able to read some pieces of these hieroglyphs. But basically, most of the message there was missing. We were not able to read it. And I believe, you know, with some, just let me say this, with some caveats, that in cosmology, we are probably in a very similar situation. We are reading some information from this cosmological service, but I'm pretty sure that most of it is still missing to us. And we're really missing the message, you know, from this, from our real universe, you know, about fundamental physics, the nature of dark energy, the sun of the neutrino masses, the properties of the initial conditions, you know, fundamental physics. So basically, I will try to motivate, you know, we need simulations because we want, at the end of the day, compare like real data, what we observe versus our simulations as a function of, let's say, cosmology, and try to see what are the value of the cosmological parameters that best match with what we observe. And for this, you know, what can we do? Can we use analytic methods? I'm not sure, right? I mean, some of the smartest people in the planet has been working on this for many years. It's not easy to do this at the level of the field. So I'm not sure if we will be able to do this. On the other hand, if we run simulations, you know, you can in principle go into the nonlinear regime, and you can even take into account baryonic effects and all these things. So that's why I think my motivation for this talk is that simulation really allow us to kind of simulate like the real data, and then we can really compare. So that's basically the motivation. Okay, so what kind of simulation do we have? There are basically two main types of simulation. On one hand, there is the n-body simulations. These are gravity only, so we only simulate the gravity force. These are expensive, and I will say they are valid in the regime that are not affected by baryons. At the end of the talk, I will be briefly talking about this. I think they can be verified. Some people have done this. I'm not sure if this simulation can be validated. And this is kind of a very important thing. I would like to touch this at the end of the talk. And the typical thing that people has been using this simulation is, you know, can be done for many things, but the typical things is to study structure formation, maybe also halo formation, and of course, many other things. And then on the other hand, we have the full hydrodynamical simulation where we not only take into account gravity, but we also solve the fluid dynamic equation. So, you know, you model, for instance, the cosmic gas, but you also try to model, you know, astrophysical processes, like, for instance, the formation of a star, the formation of a black hole, the feedback from these objects. So these simulations are even more expensive. I will say, still with some quote marks, that they are valid on all resolved scales. I'm not sure if this simulation can be validated, maybe verified. It's very, very hard, I think, in this case. And typically, this simulation has been done to study galaxy formation. Of course, can be done for many other things, but kind of this is kind of a typical example. Okay, so what do we have right now in terms of n-body simulation, you know, in the community, 2021? So we have all this amazing set of simulations, and most of these are public available. And it's really remarkable, right? I mean, what is out there? So just to name a few, and apologies again if I'm missing anyone. We have Uchu, Emulus, Baco, Quixote, Flapsheet, Darkwest, Abacus. So let me show you, for instance, some movie. I don't know if you will be able to maybe see this. Hopefully, yes. So this is, for instance, for the Uchu simulation. I think this is mostly done in Japan by Japanese people, but there is also collaborators in other places. I think this simulation has like 2 gigaparsec, and they have trillions of particles. So, you know, in 2021, we can afford to run a simulation where you cover a very representative volume of the universe, and you are able to resolve, I guess in this case, they resolve, I'm pretty sure, at least 10 to the 11, solar masses, dark matter halos, but maybe it's even higher resolution. I should maybe have look at this in more detail. And of course, if someone knows this, please feel free to correct me. And you can see here like the typical process of structure formation. You start with a very homogeneous and isotropic field, and then gravity will amplify these small fluctuations and give rise to the cosmic web. You know, you will form dark matter halos, clusters, voids. You can see the filaments, and you can see all these things. So this is, you know, we have there. And this is, I'm not sure if this simulation is public available, but there are many others that there are. Another one which is really impressive is the Abacus Summit. So this is a set of simulations. They have more than 100 simulations. They also simulate almost 100 different cosmologies. And I believe in every simulation here, they also have like trillions of particles. So every simulation here is like 2 gigaparsecs. So again, a very large volume, something very representative of the universe. And they are able to resolve dark matter halos of 10 to the 11, which I think fulfills the requirement for things like Euclid and DESI. And I believe this is also public available. Another thing is this Quixote simulation. In this case, there are even more simulations, like 44,000, but they have like lower resolution. So in this case, the idea is that you cover a volume that is larger than the volume of the entire observable universe at every redshift, and you have thousands of different cosmologies. So in this particular case, I know very well, so everything is public available. And you know, all these things are there. And there are many others, and this is kind of the state of embodied simulation right now. We have all these amazing tools, and we can do a lot of science with this. But still, there are some, I would say, I don't know, problems, in the sense that, of course, we would like to improve on some things. So what are some problems, that, if I can say in this way? So the first of all is that if you want to sample the parameter space more densely, I don't know, you want to make an emulator or you are doing some NCNC, so you really need to sample very, very finely, then right now it's not really possible, I will say, to run these kind of simulations for every point in parameter space. You know, if you are doing an NCNC chain or something like that, right now I don't think it's feasible to do this. Storage needs, you know, I think all of us running simulation, we would like to save petabytes of data. I mean, you know, if you can save 1,000 snapshots, why not? But usually the system administrator are not very happy with this, believe me. So, you know, you of course have to just keep some snapshots. So, you know, sometimes you would like to say, I would like to have maybe this snapshot. So, you know. High resolution is a problem. So even embodied simulation began very, very time-consuming whenever you increase the resolution. In that case, you start resolving smaller and smaller halos, and the orbits become you know, much, much smaller. And of course, you need much more time to do these things. So this is very expensive. And another problem of embodied simulation, I would say, is that they are embodied simulation, right? So we are only solving, taking into account gravity. We know that in the real universe, there are other things that matter. So this is where I believe machine learning can definitely give us a hand. So one task for these emulators. We have been having talks about this. You know, there was Georgia yesterday, Marco. I think today I was sleeping, so I apologize, but maybe Mishimishi and Miyatake talk about this. So a typical task is to create an emulator, right? So for instance, imagine that you want to emulate the power spectrum as a function of cosmology. And the idea there is you don't want to run a simulation for every point in parameter space and compute the power spectrum. You want to do something quicker than that. So in this case, you know, the idea is that you run some simulation in some point in parameter space and basically you interpolate somehow. And in this case, you know, people have been using Gaussian processes. You can do neural networks. There are many things. And, you know, we also heard, like for instance, Cosmo Bauer and all these things that are really amazing. So this is a kind of very traditional application, and you know, you don't have to do this only for the power spectrum. You can do this for bispectrum. I mean, we will see how many simulations you will need for other statistics, but it can be done for any summary statistics that you want. Okay, something that I believe is going to be the future is to do emulators at the field level. So again, we have also heard talks about this. You know, there was Davide, Denise the other day. We have Floppy N, and you know, with all the machinery we've born, this will be of course great. So there has been some work about this. The first two papers, I believe, were Inley and CUG and collaborators like Shirley Ho, where basically where they were done, what they did, was to train neural networks to basically correct the displacement field that you will get if you just use the Zeldovich approximation going all the way to an n-body simulation or something like FastBN, like an approximate simulation. And they show that it works very well. So I just want to mention here quickly like this work that this has been done by a student at Michigan Tech, Neraf Kosal. So in this case, what we are doing is to, instead of starting from Zeldovich, what we do is to run Cola, which is one of these fast simulations. You can use FastBN, FlopBN, whatever you want. And then you will get something like this. And then you run your full embodied, and you get something like that. So basically, you can train a neural network to correct basically the position that Cola produces, and it works very well, right? So I think maybe there is nothing surprising there. Well, what we find that is really amazing is that you train this thing for a fixed cosmology with some fixed values of the cosmological parameters, and somehow, magically, when you test this model for any other cosmology, even if the cosmology is very, very, very far away, it works. And at least at the level of the power spectrum, it's accurate below 1% all the way to KF1. So basically, you know, you can run your Cola and you can automatically correct this to get kind of the full embody in a very, very cheap way. So yeah, this is something I think is very promising. And there is also a work that is coming out from Drew Jamison, who is now a postdoc at MPA, who is doing the styling part. So, you know, doing the Zeldovich approximation to the full embody, but using a style, style net, and basically only condition on the value of omega matter. And also in this case, it works amazingly well. So I believe that this is really something very promising. Another typical task is to do data generation. You know, sometimes you run your simulation and, you know, for some reason, maybe you would like to have even more data and more data. So, you know, things like GANs are perfect for this kind of task. And there has been several works, and I'm pretty sure there should be more. Again, apologies if I miss someone. And the idea here is that you run your simulation, you produce data, and then you can use these generative models to really learn, like basically to generate new data, sometimes the manifold where the data lives, so you can sample it and you can generate new data. Another thing that is related to the thing that they said before, sometimes you have limited computational resources. So for instance, you can only produce a snapshot, maybe at a different redshift, a few redshift. What happened if you need to produce a snapshot at a different redshift? So, you know, we did this work. This is led by Chan Chen, who was a PhD student at NYU. Well, the idea is that you have two snapshots from an n-body simulation at two different redshifts, let's say redshift one, redshift zero, and maybe you want to produce like a snapshot at redshift 0.5. So again, you can train a neural network, a CNN, very easily for do this, like a typical unit. And this thing seems to work very well. So, you know, things like this can alleviate the problems that we have in terms of storage and these kind of things. Something that I think is more interesting, and I think this is really something that is going to be, like, I believe is going to change maybe this whole business, is the super resolution. As I was mentioning before, simulations become very, very expensive as you increase the resolution. So, you know, even for embodied simulation running very large volumes with very high resolution, this is still very, very expensive. But, you know, when you look at the cosmic web, you can see that there is a structure there. There is a pattern, right? It's not like when we look at images of planes and elephants and all these things where, you know, it's... Here in the larger scale structure, there is definitely a structure, and we can use machine learning to basically take advantage of this. So, you know, the first work that was done in this direction was by Duguesz, that I believe many of you in Paris know. So Duguesz lead this project that we have with Ben also, and with Tom and myself, where the idea was to take a low resolution n-body simulation, and then you condition this using the high resolution initial conditions from an n-body simulation, and then you combine the two of them and you are able to produce like the high resolution n-body, and it works very well. So more recently, in a very different way, Inli from the CCA and collaborators from the Carnegie Mellon, they have been using more, in this case using GANs, StyleGAN, I believe. They have been doing a similar exercise in the sense that, you know, they run a very low resolution in body simulation, and then they use these kind of techniques to increase the resolution. And you can see here some of the images. This is really a spectacular work. You know, it's really amazing. And they have done an amazing work looking at many different properties, and it seems to be working very well. So I really think that there is a lot of future in this super resolution. Okay, so this was a little bit from the part of the body simulations. Now let me go to the full hydro, right? Like hardcore. So I have taken this plot or picture from a paper from Mark Volgersberger, who show basically what do we have right now in terms of hydrodynamical simulation, state of the art. Right now we have, you know, Illustris CNG, Magneticum, Simbar, Romulus, Massive Black, Eagle, Horizon Agent, and hopefully I'm not missing anyone, so apologies again if I miss. So these simulations are basically the result of decades of work by incredibly amazing and incredibly capable people, right? So this is a state of the art, and these simulations are so realistic in these days that we are able to really compare with real data, and it's really amazing. So in the same way as maybe I didn't mention foreign body simulation, if you're working on some project and you're with this simulation, you fulfill your scientific needs, use it, right? I mean, there is no need to use machine learning if we have like the full proper simulation. So even if these simulations are amazing, that they are, there is, as you can imagine, oh, let me show you here like one video, sorry, I forgot. So I think I took this from the Illustris TNG website. I think this is the evolution of a galaxy from the Illustris TNG 50 simulation. I believe that this is the gas field. You can see the large scale structure around this galaxy here. You can see how things are collapsing. I think this dark matter halo. I believe this is the stellar component of this galaxy, and I believe this is just assuming in the gas region. So you can see here the reason why we need full hydrodynamical simulation, right? Because the process of galaxy formation and galaxy evolution is incredibly complex, right? You have the galaxy that is rotating, you have the accretion from gas, you have mergers, from time to time you can see that there is some gas that is expelled. I believe that this is supernova feedback or AGN feedback. You can see the beautiful disk galaxies that they produce. I believe maybe a thin disk. And it's amazing, right? I mean, these simulations are really amazing. But they are really, really expensive, right? Running this kind of simulation takes a very, very, very long time. And yeah, I believe that, you know, if we want to do precision cosmology, we definitely need this kind of simulations. So this is a Stein Evolves, and yeah, maybe I should. I didn't know that this movie was so long. Okay, but you get basically the idea. Okay, so this simulation, again, are amazing, but still, of course, you can imagine that there are some, I'm not sure I call this problem, but things definitely that were, you know, there is room for improvement. The first problem I will say is that this simulation typically they cover a small volume. And the reason for this is that, you know, you want to really resolve galaxies, so you need high resolution. And basically this limits basically the cosmological volume that you are able to explore, right? Running something larger, it will be completely unfeasible, even at 2021, right? This is basically what we are talking here. The second thing is that we don't have really a very good knowledge of the uncertainties coming from these simulations. So in this simulation, the range of scale is very large, but still is not large enough, such as we are able to resolve like the formation of individual stars or the formation of black holes and all these other objects. So usually what we do is to use these subgrid physics. Basically, these are phenomenological models that can be more or less motivated by physics, but I believe they are phenomenological models at the end of the day. And this model comes with some parameters that, you know, might not be very physical in most of the cases. So what at the end of the day, I think in cosmology, where we are now in an era of precision cosmology, what we want to do is to marginalize over this, right? We cannot really trust simulation where you fix these parameters, even if they reproduce some observations, I believe. So as there is basically no, it has not been this done before, as far as I know. And then another problem is that I will not be talking high resolution, of course. I mean, if you increase the resolution of this simulation, this becomes even more expensive, and also storage, right? I mean, this is always a problem. So let me start covering the first problem about how we are going to deal with the small volume. So there are more classical techniques where you don't really need, for instance, a machine learning. There is this baryonification technique that was, I think, invented by Orel and Snyder and Romain Tessier already in 2016. And, you know, the idea here is that, you know, you run your embodied simulation, you have your dark matter halos, and then you basically assume that within these dark matter halos, there will be some stellar component, you know, maybe from the central galaxy that will follow some profile. And then you assume that there is some gas that will be in hydrostatic equilibrium, maybe some fraction of the gas will be ejected, and then you make some assumption about the profiles and these things. And you know, you can basically paint this kind of features in your embody. And people have shown that this is quite accurate, right? You are able to reproduce, for instance, results from the power spectrum from full hydro. So this is, you know, something very promising. And in this case, I believe we don't really involve machine learning. Another thing is, you know, increasing sometimes more data if in case that you need this. So the typical examples are GANs, autoencoders, or I think maybe more recently, normalizing flows. And again, I'm pretty sure there should be more citations here, apologies. I'm just showing here, like for instance, some images from in a recent paper with Sultan Hassan, who is a postdoc at CCA, where basically we took images from cosmic neutral hydrogen at high redshift, and basically we learned how to produce new ones, but this is as a function also of cosmology and astrophysics. So, you know, this kind of things works very well, and people have been using these techniques. So this is a way to augment your data. So let me also talk about another thing where many people, I think, are working, which is this thing of going from the embodied to the full hydro using machine learning or deep learning in general. So what I'm showing here are different images from different physical fields. I think this is the gas metallicity. This is the electron density, probably, you know, gas pressure, gas density, gas temperature, you know, many different fields. So there is something in common to all these images, right? Every image is different, but the thing is that if you run an embodied simulation with the same, basically the same initial conditions, what you will get is something like this. So, you know, it's not exactly the same as each of these fields, but the large scale structure is there, right? I mean, you can see the filaments are in the same place in all the fields. The dark matter halos are all there. The voids are all there. So what I mean is that the one possible way is to make your simulation much larger so we can really use them to do cosmology. You can run like a very big embodied simulation. We have this right now. I have shown you examples before. And then you can paint all these different gas or stellar properties on top of the dark matter on top of the dark matter field from an embody. And you know, when I was looking at this the other day, it's like, wow, I mean, there is really a lot of things that has been done in the literature. So again, apologies if I'm missing. So I think Ben Horovitz from Princeton is going to be talking about his recent work with the Lyman Alpha Forest. I haven't had time to look at the talk yet, but I have seen from Slack that there was a talk today by this, also about, paint basically properties to reproduce Lyman Alpha Forest from embodied simulations. With Jay, who was a PhD student at NYU, we basically went from embody to cosmic neutral hydrogen, in this case, really thinking more about 21 centimeter. Some people have been working about producing, you know, the elements that you need to do KFC and TFC, like electron pressure, electron density, electron momentum, these kind of things. So for instance, this is coming from, I took it from a paper by Leander Thiel, who is a student at Princeton. And there has been also some work done where you can paint either galaxies or galaxy properties directly on top of the dark matter field of an N-body simulation. You know, I think Chirac has a paper, but also we have several papers on this. And there is also the group of Berkeley, you know, Uros and Biwei, where they have also this other method where they are able to displace the position of the N-body simulation to reproduce like full hydro, right? So it seems to be very promising in these things. And another thing where there has been a lot of work done is to also model the halo galaxy connection. And you know, in this case, it's really that you run your N-body simulation, you find the dark matter halos, and then you paint the galaxies there. So there has been a lot of work done with this. Some of them, you know, using random forests, some of them more sophisticated. I just want to mention this work by Moster et al., where they use reinforcement learning. This probably was one of the first, or maybe the first application of reinforcement learning in astrophysics or cosmology, as far as I know. I might be wrong. And the idea here is that they run N-body simulations, and then basically they will find dark matter halos, and then they take galaxies from real data. And what they do is to use reinforcement learning to train a neural network how to paint basically galaxies on top of the dark matter halos. And in this case, they show that they are able to reproduce observations very well, not only abundance, but also clustering. And then they were able to populate a really gigantic box with galaxies. Really, I think, really impressive work. Okay, so the second problem is about these uncertainties. You know, as I mentioned before, in hydro simulation, we have astrophysical parameters that are, in many cases, responsible for this subgrid physics. The energy released by a supernova, the energy released by a black hole. And these are kind of free parameters. And, you know, I believe most of the effort in the community has been going into tune these parameters as best as possible, such as you reproduce observations. But, you know, in cosmology, I believe that the most sensible way for us to claim that, you know, we have found a deviation from lambda CDN or claim a phi sigma detection of the neutrino masses is to marginalize over these parameters. So for this, I would like to introduce you to CAMOS. So CAMOS start for cosmology and astrophysics with machine learning simulation. This is a suite of thousands of simulation, more than 4,000. Half of them are traditional embody, nothing in particular. The other half are state of the art magneto-hydrodynamical simulation. And this simulation has been run with two different codes, and we did this on purpose, right? To check these theoretical systematics that Boop was also mentioning and talking yesterday. So on one hand, we have the Arepo code, and we have been running some simulation using the same subgrid physics as the Illustris CNG model, so it's exactly the same. And the other simulation has been run with Gizmo and using the same subgrid model as SIMPA. So, you know, two state-of-the-art simulations. So we have thousands of simulations, and in every of these simulations, we vary two cosmological parameters, omega matter and sigma 8, and we also vary four astrophysical parameters. Two of them control the strength of supernova feedback, and the other two control the strength of AGN feedback. This simulation we really designed to do machine learning, as you can imagine. So the idea is that you have this gigantic parameter space. You sample it with a few simulations, as many as you can afford, and then you hope that machine learning will be able to fill the holes in between. So everything is going to be publicly available very soon, January 6, 2022. So you should expect hundreds of terabytes from this, and I think this is going to be a very exciting thing. Let me show you here one movie of to try to understand this theoretical systematics that we were talking. What I'm showing here is basically the very same exact simulation with the same initial conditions. On the left, run with the Illustris CNG code. On the right, run with SIMPA. So what you can see here, this is for the dark matter field. Things look very similar in the two cases. In this case, when you look at the gas density here, there are some differences already if you look carefully. This is the gas temperature. You can see that now things are crazy, right? I mean, these are very different. So, you know, even if these two simulations has been run with the fiducial model in both cases, and, you know, this fiducial model was basically tuned to reproduce observations, some of them, not all of them, you can see that when you look in details and these two different simulations, they are very, very different. And you know, I'm not sure if Illustris CNG is better than SIMPA. Probably none of them really represent reality. So at the end of the day, what you would like to is to marginalize over these things. And this is basically the idea of cameras. So one thing that I'm really very happy to tell you is that we have very recently released this CAMOS multi-field dataset. It's a set where we have hundreds of thousands of 2D images and also 3D grids for many different fields. So you can see here in this image, like for instance, 13 different fields from gas temperature, gas density, gas metallicity, stellar mass, dark matter, you know. And this is for every image and every grid has a different value of the cosmological and astrophysical parameters. So, you know, this is really amazing, I think, to maybe, you know, not only maybe train, maybe, let's say, PhD students who want to do, you know, they want to do machine learning cosmology, but also really to tackle some of the questions that we are finding and that we have no idea how to solve them. So, you know, this is kind of a data set for the whole community to work on it. Everything is public available, by the way, if I didn't say. So something that I'm also very, very proud, I never expected this result, is basically this plot. So this plot took me 10 million CPU hours to do it, but it works. So let me tell you exactly what is this. So what we have done is, you know, taking thousands of different maps. These are 2D maps. These are for the total matter density field, where, the same as before, every image has a different cosmology and has a different astrophysics. And the idea here was to basically, you know, train a neural network to do likelihood-free inference at the level of the field. So, you know, you try to extract all the information that is there. And not only that, marginalizing over baryonic effects at the field level. And, you know, you use Illustris CNG simulations, you train this. And when you test using Illustris CNG simulation, it works. This is usually the case, and this is usually the case for any other field. As long as you are within the same simulation, everything works. It's very easy to marginalize over baryonic effects at the field level. What we found here is that this seems to be robust. You know, when this neural network was trained, we were able to test it using maps from SIMBA, that you have seen that it's a completely different simulation, different way to solve the hydrodynamical equation, different subgrid physics, everything is different. And still it works. We were able to recover the value of omega matter and sigma 8, and the error bars are tiny. We're talking about, you know, I think like 2 or 3% constraints. And these are maps that come in from a 25 by 25 megaparsec box, a resist shield. So this indicates the gigantic amount of information that seems to be there. And another thing that we can do with this thing is that you don't have to do this for a single field. You can put all the fields that you want, you know? I mean, you can put gas temperature, gas density, gas metallicity, everything together, and the neural network would do likelihood-free inference at the field level, marginalizing over baryonic effects at the field level, but also taking into account all the cross-correlation, right? So I think this is one of the, something very exciting. And still there are some problems, so I'll be happy to tell you later about this. So regarding the future, you know, many people are working on this from many different angles. In our particular case, this is what we are trying to do. We are basically trying to take Quixote, where we have thousands of different cosmologies. We have the largest volume ever simulated. And then we want to use super resolution to basically increase the resolution of this simulation to go all the way to 10 to the 9. And in this case, we will have thousands of different simulations resolving halos of 10 to the 9. And once we go there, we can use CAMOS and we can paint on the matter field itself all the different gas and stellar properties as a function not only of cosmology, but also as a function of astrophysics. And in this case, you know, we can have in principle millions of simulations with different cosmologies and different astrophysics. These will be gigaparsec boxes resolving halos of 10 to the 9. And once you have this, you can do, you know, this likelihood-free inference, putting everything together and extracting pretty much all the information. That will be really one of the amazing things to do, and I believe many people are also working on these ideas. Since I'm running a little bit out of time, let me maybe skip this. I just want to mention a little bit about, of course, Born, that is, of course, going to play a major role in all these things. I just want to mention this beautiful paper that Jens Guion has recently, where basically, you know, you can use this kind of technique to identify where most of the information is coming from the cosmic web. And then, you can then later design your survey to look at these regions and basically to try to optimize your survey to extract the maximum amount of information. So this is really, I think it's a really beautiful work. Okay, a little bit now talking about other things that we can do with machine learning and simulations. One of them is to maybe learn physics, right? So there has been a very beautiful work by Lucy Smith. I'm just putting here a figure for her recent paper. And the idea is that, you know, you can train neural networks to try to see what are the different features, the different properties that are contributing to maybe, in this case, the formation of a dark matter halo, and try to interrogate and also designing your architecture, such as you can really learn about the physics that is underlying. Another thing that I want to quickly mention is this work that was done by Helen Shaw. So Helen is a second year undergraduate student at Princeton. And she has done, I think, this amazing work. So this is a paper that we have recently. So the idea here was to go to CAMOS. In CAMOS, we take subhalos, we identify subhalos. And then within the subhalos, you know, we can look at many different properties like gas mass, stellar mass, black hole mass, you know, all the things that is out there. And basically what we did was to use all these variables to train a neural network to see if it's able to predict the total mass of the subhalo. And this is what we got. So, you know, this is for every subhalo in the test set. This is like the true mass, and this is the predicted. And, you know, it works very well. So, you know, very cool, right? I mean, so I think the really important thing here, what is very surprising, is that we train this network using a particular simulation with some cosmology and some astrophysics. And now we took subhalos from simulation with different cosmologies, different astrophysics, different subgrid physics, different resolutions, different volumes, different recipes, and still works, right? And we were like, how is this even possible, right? So, you know, we did symbolic regression with derived some equations. And basically what we believe is that we have found some kind of version of the virial theorem. So basically we believe that the interpretation of this is that as long as you have an object that is virialized, the kinetic energy should be equal to the potential energy. And this doesn't matter, you know, what cosmology you are, what astrophysical processes are doing, what redshift, what resolution, all these things doesn't matter. So, you know, in this case, I think we already knew the virial theorem. Not sure if what we have found is exactly that, but there might be application for other things where we can hopefully maybe learn some physics. Very quickly, Jay, as I mentioned before, and now is a postdoc at the IIS in Princeton. So he has been using machine learning, but in particular also symbolic regression to improve the Y-N relationship. And, you know, he found like this equation where, you know, if you are able to measure the concentration of the gas, you will be able to reduce the scatter in this relation by almost sometimes a 30%, right? And this is something that we test with CAMOS, so it works for different cosmologies, different astrophysics, different subgrid models, so it seems to be really something physical, I will say, right? And, you know, this also motivates us to understand why is that. Okay, so this plot. So I wasn't sure really if I wanted to talk about this, but it would be very nice if people give me feedback. And also, you know, we can discuss about this. So this is something I've been working for several months already, and the results are spectacular. So let me tell you what is this. I take galaxies from CAMOS with different cosmologies, different astrophysics, a single galaxy, and from a single galaxy, I try to infer the value of omega matter. And it works. And this is basically what you get. This is doing likelihood free inference. Every point here is a different galaxy from a different simulation. It works for any galaxy with any mass, any stellar mass, any simulation. And you know, I'm not doing clustering, in case that you are wondering. I mean, you cannot do clustering. So I have no idea what is going on, but I know that it works. So, you know, I'm pretty sure that, you know, with more data, with new simulation, there will be many examples like this. And I'm not sure what we should do as a community. Should we report these results? You know, there might be some numerical artifact that is going on there. You know, I mean, maybe, you know, maybe the code itself knows about omega matter in some way. It's not clear. But, you know, what about if it's something more physical? But I have really no idea what is going on. So I'm not sure how to behave under this situation. Okay, and then for this few minutes, just to finalize, is like, you know, there will be in the coming years a lot of results where, you know, we're going to use machine learning with simulations. And the question that usually I ask, and I guess everybody asks themselves, is can we trust these, let's say, neuro simulations? So, you know, recently I was invited to a workshop, I think in UC Irvine. The name of this workshop was called Philosophical Aspect of Cosmological Simulations. The first time that I got the email, it's like, okay, this should be some scam, you know. But it was not. It was actually a very, very interesting workshop where basically some simulators, we were meeting with some philosophers that for some reason, you know, they study these things. And one of the conclusions, or at least the conclusion of one person, was that the level of the simulation that we have in cosmology is very, very low in comparison with other fields. So, you know, the first time that you heard this from a philosopher is a little bit of a shock. You know, it took me some time to recover about this. But I've been thinking a lot about this, and it's true. So basically, you know, they said that we should always do validation and verification. And, you know, whether some verification has been done, I think validation is incredibly hard with these simulations. In the sense that, you know, even when we have things like the softening length, we don't really know what is going on, or, you know, if this is really converging to the true solution. So, you know, here is a plot. Many people have done this kind of plots where we show the very same embodied simulation run with three different codes, Gadget, Rancis, and Abacus. And the agreement is very good, but the agreement is not at the sat percent level all the way to the Nyquist frequency in this case. So, you know, even when we use embodied simulation, we have to take some steps regarding this. We cannot just trust the results of embodied simulation as they are. I have the feeling that it's shifting a little bit, you know. Now there might be many people who just, oh, this is an embodied simulation, I can just trust it, and that's not really true. You always have to make sure that you can trust your simulation. And, you know, if we talk about hydro, this is even worse, right? I mean, in this case, I think beyond doing some code comparison, not sure if there is really ways to do maybe some other verification once you start, you know, putting all the physics and everything. So there is this amazing work by the Agora project in this direction. So the question is, how are we going to deal with this, with the results of full, let's say, neuro simulations? So I think the same as with embodied simulations and with any other simulation, I think we need to carry out some convergence tests, resolution tests, and all these things to make sure that the what we produce with machine learning is something meaningful. When we are working at the level of the field, it's not that clear to me how we are going to do this. And, you know, I've been thinking if, you know, computing some kind of distance like the Wasserstein distance might give us, but, you know, probably this distance will never be zero. So in that case, you know, it's going to be very hard.
3 more minutes.
I'm almost done, yes. Thank you. And we have to be very careful with extrapolation, of course. And it's, you know, it's not really clear to me how we are going to deal with this. These are just some thoughts for maybe discuss. So let me conclude here. So I have tried to motivate, you know, the usage of simulations to basically pursue this dream that I think we have in cosmology. That I think for, I would say probably all of us, this would have been really a dream a few years ago. And now I think for many of us, we are starting to realize that this is possible, then this, the idea of basically reading all the all the information that is in the universe, all the information that is available to us. I'm not sure if, you know, I will be able to see this, maybe my daughter or maybe my grandsons, but at some point we will be there. So, you know, simulation requires many resources, computing time, storage, and machine learning can be used to basically help to solve some of these problems. So can be used as a high dimensional interpolation. We can generate new data. We can speed up simulation. We can lower the storage needs. We can also use it to learn about new physics. I haven't talked about fine anomalies, but of course, and there are many other things. So I think this field is just starting. I think this is going to be it's going to be amazing. And it's a very exciting time to be. If we have this workshop in 5 or 10 years time from now, I believe things are going to be so different. And yeah, so I'll stop here. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Thanks, Paco, for this very enlightening and very exciting talk. So it seems to be very interesting and a very prosperous future for this field. So I'm opening the floor for questions. Please, yeah, I see a question over there.
Hi, thank you for a very interesting talk. My name is Natalia Korsako. I'm a postdoc at the Observatory of Paris. I was wondering, when you talked about smooth particle hydrodynamics, and I haven't heard you mentioning people using graph networks for that. I read some papers where people use graph networks for smooth particle hydrodynamics, but not in terms of astronomy. So I wonder if people are trying to do that.
Yeah, that's a very good question. So yeah, I think there are some papers by the DeepMind people where they, as far as I know, maybe someone can also comment, where you know, they use the typical example. You know, you have a glass and you put some water, so you know the water itself will do something, but the water does. So I think they have been using like GNNs to model these things, and I think they got like amazing results. I'm not sure about for astrophysics. Yeah, maybe Shirley Holm has been thinking about this, but this definitely is something that we should consider to speed up simulation. I mean, some of these hydrodynamics are very local, so I think GNNs will be perfect for this task.
Yeah.
Thanks for the talk. It's Niall Jeffrey. I had a question about painting in the baryonic effects using smaller patches. I have a kind of uneasy feeling about taking the small patches and covering them over a much bigger area, just on the kind of gut feeling that you're going to lose the large-scale correlations. Is there any way of putting that back in as well? Thanks.
That's a very good question, Niall. Yeah, we have been thinking a lot about this. So typically, because you miss the large scale modes, and typically, I think one of the most important things that this will be reflected is in the fact that, for instance, your clusters will not be maybe as representative as they are, right? Because you lose all these large scale modes. So yeah. So we have been thinking, for instance, doing this with zooming simulations. So you can run, you know, a full hydrodynamical simulation, but only a zoom region, and in this case you can do the mapping in that region. You know, if you have a cluster, you can do the mapping at that level, you know, for this very particular object. And this is, for instance, something that we are doing in camels. I have been told, you know, from other people that you know, if we look at halos of, you know, 10 to the 10, 10 to the 11, 10 to the 12, probably even 10 to the 13, even with the small boxes, we are completely representative. So unless you are interested maybe on void, something very extreme, where you will have to maybe deal with the zoomings, I think should be fine. So, yeah.
Other questions in the room? Yeah, I hear there are tons of questions on Slack, and let's see what the swarm has to say about this. Can we get some questions from Slack?
Yeah, so the question from Stefan, it says, it feels like a perfect or even satisfying agreement between various numerical simulation codes can only be achieved if they end up being coded in pretty much the same way, same recipes, which would defeat the purpose of checking if they give the true answer, i.e. the one closest to the real universe, real physics. Thoughts? Question mark.
It's a super good question. What I can tell you is that, for instance, this thing that I've been mentioning before of, you know, train a CNN at the level of the matter field, train on illustrious TNG and predict it on SIMBA, it works. But for any other field, basically, it doesn't work. You know, if you use, for instance, the gas temperature or the gas density, the electron density, this thing doesn't work. And we have no idea how is that possible, because, you know, in CAMELS, we vary this range so much that we were expecting that they would low overlap. But maybe they don't overlap. And from a more technical point of view, we are now in CAMELS, including, for instance, RANSYS, which is a completely different code with a completely different way to solve the hydrodynamical equation. Everything, it will be very nice to use as an independent data set. But this is also coming back to this question of that the philosopher was mentioned in this workshop. It's about validation. You know, if the only thing that we can do is code comparison, but all the simulations are, you know, kind of designed to do at the end of the day the same thing. You know, I've been talking by experts that in all the simulation, basically you assume a strong feedback, but, you know, it might be something else. That's always like the risk about this, right? That we trust maybe our simulation, but what happened if our simulation don't really overlap with reality? How much are we going to trust these results, right? So I don't have an answer for that. And yeah, it will be great to also discuss this in detail. Yeah, no idea.
Yeah, there's another question on Slack from Mark Huertas, who says, regarding the estimation of omega matter with one galaxy, did you try to break it, i.e. what is the smallest scale at which you can still recover omega matter?
Sorry, I haven't given a lot of detail. If anyone is interested, I'll be... we should definitely talk later. So I not even consider any scale in the sense that I just take in a single galaxy and I take the properties of the galaxy. So, you know, it works for all the galaxies that we have in CAMELS. So I think the minimum one, the stellar mass goes from 10 to the 8, you know, in this case is barely resolved, and then all the way to 10 to the 11 and above. So, yeah. It's using Intelland properties in that case.
One more. Yeah, so the last one is from, there's another one just arrived, but Ninian Liago, thanks for an amazing review talk. I'm wondering if you have insights on what strategies can help encourage a network to learn physical relationships, like learning the virial theorem. Hard question.
Yeah, it's a very hard question. You know, to be honest, I think in this thing that we did with the virial theorem, I think we were very lucky. Because also these variables depend on physical quantities. So for instance, if we would have trained this network at high redshift, they would have never, for instance, be able to extrapolate. Because then you need to give by hand the physical, for instance, radius of a galaxy, not the comoving radius. So I think the symbolic regression part is something very promising. There is a lot of work to be done in that direction. But in general, it's going to be a very hard problem, to be honest. Some of the ideas that Ben has been discussing on Monday, also yesterday in the debate, lower the dimensionality, try to maybe look at this parameter space. Also not super clear to me.
Yeah, there's a bunch of other questions on Slack, but you probably should go through them yourself.
Yeah. Are there some more questions from within the room? I don't see any. Then I have a hypothetical question. Suppose we use this entire machinery, like simulation-based inference, based on these simulations, we apply it to data, and we get very significant results for a cosmology that we don't expect. So the entire purpose of this thing is that we can do enormous amounts of these high-resolution, very complex simulations very quickly. How would you convince yourself that the results that you obtain are actually valid without running the original simulations.
Yeah. So I asked the same question, yes, just to on Monday. I don't know. Maybe we should try to look for, anomalies. But this is going to be hard. Not sure. Apologies that I'm not more explicit about that. I asked the same question the other day, and also.
Well, that's fine. I'm going to keep on asking that question. So, is there any other question in the room? If not, I thank Paco again. Please, applause.
Thank you, guys.
Yes, and we'll have a break right now for those people. We'll meet in 21